you so much for coming today. I'm just going to tell you a bit, first of all, about myself, why I'm here, just to give you a bit of personal information about me as well. My name is Sheena, and I've been an ethical vegan for 6 years, but prior to that, I was a vegetarian for 35 years. I went vegetarian as a result of, well, I used to be a punk, used to do like, they had a fanzine, they were called, and we did like magazines and interviews with punk bands, and used to go to gigs and buy fanzines off other people, and then there'd be all this information, we'd swap fanzines and sell fanzines and stuff like this. And in one of those fanzines, there was a link to a band called Conflict. We all far too young to remember Conflict. And they had a song called Meat is Murder. And bought the album, listened to the lyrics of the song, and that was it. Now, this was obviously prior to the days of internet and stuff like that, so all the information you can probably see now on social media is through Facebook, Twitter, didn't have that. So it was a very sort of casual, easygoing way of passing information through books, fanzines, and that was what made me go vegetarian when I was 14 years old. I'm 51 years old now, and I go to the gym 5 times a week, sometimes successfully, sometimes not. I try to aim to walk to about 20,000-25,000 steps a day. I also have a business teaching dance and drama. I do lots of cycling in the summer, and I also run a vegan food business called Truffle Up Against Vegan Meals. I'm also a vegan activist, and by that I mean I deliver peaceful talks and education to after schools and workshops and to the public. I'm also very, very lucky at the moment to have no health issues. And also during my life I've completed many, many fitness challenges, including the 4-peak challenge and cycling yoga. As a vegetarian, I also power walked over 10 marathons, and I completed a 104-mile walk in 36 hours. Health has been an unexpected bonus to go vegan, and now at 51, I've been healthier than I ever have. And I also run an over 50s vegan health page to inspire women and men to not dead from the neck down in our middle years. So, what exactly are we here for today? We're here to talk about veganism. This is the definition of veganism from the Vegan Society. Now, it's not a group that you have to join to be a vegan, but it outlines what a vegan means. And a vegan means it's a way of living which seeks to exclude, as far as is possible and practical, all forms of exploitation of and cruelty to animals for food, clothing, or any other purpose. Now, what that means is we're not perfect. Sometimes we step on ants. Sometimes we're brushing bacteria away with our toothpaste. That's not what it's about. It's about doing the absolute best that we can. Veganism is also a huge right, and I'm sure many of you know that. And foods that are avoided are fish, milk, eggs, cheese, and honey. And also any B numbers that are derived from animals. These can be found in foodstuffs and wine. Veganism is an ethical stance that also seeks to avoid any product from animals such as fur, silk, wool, and the use of cosmetics, products and protect animals. Being vegan does not mean that you're angry or superior or in a cult or mad, or that we hate people who eat meat. However, this all sounds very negative, of all things that we can't eat. What can we eat? There are many, many foods that can be eaten, including all grains, beans, pulses, nuts, seeds, fruits, vegetables, and the ever-growing range of meat, egg, and fish substitutes that can be included in a vegan lifestyle. And vegans can also eat plant versions of burgers, lasagnas, pies, curries, and even good fry. There are also many reasons why people choose to go vegan. A lot of people choose it for health, excuse me, and one funnel that came out a couple of years ago was called Bob Health, and it outlines the health benefits of a plant, whole food plant-based diet and the impact that meat and dairy can have on your health. It's a very, very interesting film. It's linked in the page that I'm giving out to you. So people choose it for health as a higher fibre, lower cholesterol diet that includes less meat and dairy and more fruits, vegetables and grains has been scientifically proven to be much healthier. A lot of vegans choose to go vegan because of the environment, as plants use less water to grow, less land, and also create less greenhouse gases. 70% of arable land across the planet is used currently to grow grains for cattle. It's 70% of potential growth for human consumption. And because there's so many cattle in the world, and pigs, sheep, that land is being used to feed them first and foremost because of our need for meat and chicken, fish and eggs. So it's just an interesting thing to know. So that's why a lot of people choose to go vegan for the environment. And of course, a lot of people choose to go vegan for the animals. More than 56 billion wild animals are killed every single year for food consumption. And that doesn't even take into consideration the amount used for experiments, entertainment, or for clothing. The amount of fish hauled into the sea is so enormous that it's not even counted in numbers. Tons and millions of tons are dragged from the ocean every single year. This pig was a photograph from a farm in Ballymena on the morning that I seen you guys. That was about 4 weeks ago. And the farm has since been closed down. There are also many buzzwords for people trying out a vegan lifestyle. You've probably heard a lot of them. Mostly are related to diet. Plant-based, whole food plant-based, high carb, low fat, and it's diet that we're going to be focusing on here today. I'm sure you're aware that there are many top athletes now changing to a vegan and plant-based lifestyle and stating that they experience better performance, better recovery time, more energy and better sleep. This is Patrick Baboumian. He won Germany's Strongest Man. This is Kim Constable. You might know her, you might have seen her training in Northern Ireland. She runs the Sculpted Vegan, used to be her personal chef. and she has an online fitness business, and she looks after it in real life. This is Nathan from the main Vegan Fitness, and Nimai Delgado, just because he's very attractive. I'll put him in there. So these are all vegan bodybuilders. This guy here was vegetarian from birth and went vegan 6 years ago. So many of your clients will now be referring to themselves as vegan. One of the most important things that you can provide your new client with is an understanding of what that means. Do not be afraid to ask your client questions, but research and educate yourself on the vegan lifestyle so that you are able to provide your client with the best knowledge for them to grow and improve in their fitness journey. Do not sneer or mock their lifestyle, or you will have lost a client. It's imperative to keep up to date on veganism, as you'll be seeing a huge growth in vegan clients as more and more people become aware of the health, environmental, and of course, animal rights impacts. So we're going to do a quiz. Okay, protein. Okay, that's one of the first things that everybody always wants to know. Where do you get your protein from? So, does anybody know how much protein is in one large egg? very good, it is about 6 grams of protein. Does anybody know how many grams of protein are in 100 grams of tofu? 100 grams of tofu, that's a block about that size there. 100 grams of tofu, anybody can have a guess?
4.
You think many?
4.
4. No, we've got 4. 4. No, less. 9 grams of protein in 100 grams of tofu. However, tofu has 0 cholesterol and only 76 calories per 100 grams. And both are similar-ish in fat content, but tofu is lower in saturated fat, 0.7 compared to 1.6 in the egg. Can you list me now 4 meat, fish and cheese alternatives to protein? Use one on the planet. Any alternatives to protein?
Corn.
Pardon?
Corn, sir.
Corn, yeah.
Beans.
Beans, yeah. Nuts, yeah, very good. Okay, so we have tofu, nuts, chia seeds, sunflower seeds, tempeh, that's another version of tofu that's I'll come back to that one. We've got beans, there's avocados, broccoli, there's a lot of not a lot of protein, but it's some protein in vegetables as well. And the vegan meats and seitan, which is very high protein, 20 grams per 100 grams, plant milks, and some vegetables. So there are some debates about what humans should be eating in terms of protein, and one study, the China study, which was written by father and son, T. Colin and Thomas Campbell in 2005, this was the most extensive study ever undertaken on human nutrition and illness that spread over 30 years. It states that as Westerners, we eat far, far too much protein, and long-term overuse of protein can cause a myriad of health issues. This, of course, is a very detailed and complex book, which we don't have time, obviously, to go into now, but it debunks the myth that we need animal protein to grow big and strong. And while we may look great on the outside with a high-protein, meat-centered diet, we may not be doing so well on the inside. So please be open to finding out and researching a wee bit about this book and the relationship and obsession with protein. Dr. Michael Greger is an American physician who has written many books on the health benefits of a whole food, plant-based diet. And in your sheets, I've linked you to his book, How Not to Die, and it's a brilliant resource also called nutrition.org to help you in your plans with all things nutrition related. And it's not just one doctor that's saying it, there's hundreds of doctors and physicians across the world and mainly America who come up with facts, scientifically proven facts for this website. So back to the tofu. What can you recommend that your clients do with it? You can make scrapple, just like with eggs. You can roll it like a steak, or you can make it into kebabs or curries. That's just one of the uses you can do with tofu. So who knows how much iron is in 100 grams of steak? I trained to be a fitness instructor 25 years ago, and nutrition was a very, very small part of it. It really wasn't something that we did. It's something that you had to really learn in your own time. I think we did one module on it, which lasted an afternoon. So it is something that you do need to be reading up on. So steak has 2.73 grams of iron per 100 grams. So we will have a fair guess of how many might be in 100 grams of chickpeas. And again, chickpeas have a lot less fat and calories and much more fiber, which is essential for a healthy body. Iron-rich foods include spinach, apricots, dates, figs, lentils, broccoli, tofu, mung beans, chia, flax, and even chocolate is high in iron. So what can we do with chickpeas? Of course, familiar hummus, curries again, salads, or you can roast them and eat them as a snack, and much healthier than crisps. So what about calcium? We're told that we need to have calcium to make our bones big and strong. Now whenever I was expecting my baby, when I was 20 years old, I was actually vegan for a couple of years then, and it was a lot more difficult than it is now. I didn't have the same information. In fact, the only information I have was a book written by Yakin Phoenix's parents, who were like hippies, and they lived on the land, and they had this cookbook, and she brought all of her sons up vegan, and I don't know if she daughters or not. And that was the only reference book that I had to help me being vegan. So it was very, very difficult then, and obviously when you are having a baby, you want to make sure that you're giving your baby the best nutrition. I wasn't sure that it was the right thing then. I know differently now, but this was 30 years ago. So, one thing that my doctors actually told me was that my baby would be born with no spine because I wasn't taking enough calcium in. But what we now are discovering is that the high protein and high fat content of milk actually strips the calcium from your bones and actually can cause osteoporosis rather than being the cure for it. So it's very interesting to do a bit of research on that as well. So, vitamin D needs to be taken alongside calcium to aid absorption, which is easily achieved with fortified plant margarines or using a supplement, which most of us need in this grey and not very sunny climate. Most vegans are advised to supplement with vitamin D due to the lack of sun, and many feel that this is a just and fair compromise to avoid animal pain and suffering. So there's just some of the calcium-rich foods that you can take that don't involve dairy or actually legally acceptable in the UK, in the US, and in Europe to have up to 2% of the volume of the milk, foot, or pus from infected breast tissues. In the US, they allow 750 million pus cells in 1 liter of milk. In Europe, regulators allow 400 million. B12 is another vitamin that vegans are often asked about. But it's something that not just vegans need to be concerned about. A lot of meat eaters are also deficient in B12. So where does it come from? For clarity, vitamin B12 comes from soy, and it's ingested by animals who are grass-fed only. Most cattle, pigs, sheep are not grass-fed. They live their lives in factory farms, which means they have the B12 artificially added to their diet. So they are taking the supplements, filtered through them, and given to your bodies through meat. So the best way to get B12 naturally is to eat vegetables grown in soil, or soil itself. Not very appetizing. Because we wash and rinse our vegetables now, we don't get our B12 that way. So we do need to take a supplement, and again, a small price to pay to avoid an animal being suffering. But if we do eat a wide range of vegetables, green vegetables, whole grains, legumes, calcium-rich foods and fruit, you will be getting an extremely well-balanced and healthy diet. And these are quite simple nutrients. In the most sustainable way, the best way to get them is through plants. For an ever-growing population hurtling towards 8 billion, we need to look at ways to reduce land use, to reduce deforestation, and to reduce water consumption. And the main drivers of all three of these assaults on the planet is animal agriculture. To reduce animal agriculture, we need to make smarter and healthier moves towards a vegan lifestyle. I'm summarising here, but I've written down many links you can follow up if you're interested in the packs that you receive at the end. But of course, do your own research as well. It's not just me saying this. This is not just anecdotal evidence. The National Health Service, the British Dietetic Society, and the American Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics have all said that a well-planned vegan diet is adequate from all ages, from pregnancy to birth, all the way through childhood, through to old age. And to be as strong as an ox, you've got to eat like an ox. And let's not forget that the biggest, the strongest, and the longest living animals are all vegan. So thank you very much for listening. This is just the tip of the iceberg lettuce on all the information that is out there. And now it's time for us to enjoy our lunch. I'd also just like to say, a big thank you to Lush. They have donated, very, very kindly donated, a lovely pack of vegan and non-tested bananas products for you all to use. And I've put together a little pack for you all that includes some leaflets, some information, and a list of some of the links that I have provided in this talk for you to do your own research and find out even more so that you can give your clients the best information when they come to you asking, how can I get big and strong as a vegan? So thank you very much, everybody. Have a good time, and I have some treats for you. There is some slow roasted jackfruit with rice and peas and peanut satay sauce. And there is baked spiced tofu with roasted vegetable and rice salad and peanut satay, and slow roasted barbecue jackfruit, rice and beans, coleslaw and garlic mayo.